Welcome to Smith Weekly Discussions, an occasional program for our members of Smith Weekly Research. Please note this program is a private discussion and everything contained herein is for entertainment and educational purposes only. With that, we hope you're in a comfortable position, along with your favorite beverage, to enjoy the discussion. We remind our audience to examine our show notes attached to each of our shows to better understand how our program functions. Before we get into our discussion, we want to say thanks for questions coming from our audience at Smith Weekly, including Ken S., Jackie A., Jared W., and Paul M. Back on the show today is Mr. Paul Goranson. Paul is the Chief Executive Officer at Encore Energy. The company is a United States in-situ recovery-focused uranium development and near-term production-capable company with various stage projects spread across Texas, Wyoming, South Dakota, New Mexico, Arizona, Colorado, and Utah. Within the project portfolio is core projects at Rosita, Texas, Dewey Burdock, South Dakota, and Gas Hills, Wyoming. Encore is a uranium portfolio company at Smith Weekly Research, as well as within our elite service. Encore Energy is listed on the Toronto Venture Exchange under the symbol EU, and also on the US OTC markets under the symbol ENCUF. Mr. Goranson, welcome back to the program. How are you, sir?
I'm doing just fine. Thanks for having me back, and Happy New Year.
Yeah, absolutely. Happy New Year to you, Paul. And it looks like things are kicking off with fireworks. They're still bursting in air over the skies here. And so looks like it's going to be an interesting 2022 on a lot of fronts, inclusive of uranium markets. Well, let's kick it off here. How about an update on the recently closed Arzaga transaction, and with both new holders and existing holders of Encore now in there, what can they expect over the course of the year?
Well, we've already hit the ground running. So currently we're continuing to execute our plan at Rosita. We're also, bringing it. We started drilling out there in November, and we're starting to build towards installing well fields at Rosita and also at one of our other projects in South Texas and called the Upper Spring Creek project, as well as completing the capital program at Rosita. We're also going to be kicking off the permitting and licensing process for the Gas Hills project to take that project from being effectively a proposed project to actual execution. So that'll start this year. And we're going to continue to advance the Dewey Burdock project, getting all the government approvals completed and begin to the first part of developing it, hopefully in 2023. Looking forward to this year. It's going to be a very busy year as we bring all these, execute on all these programs going forward.
Lots of things happening, Paul, and you, Bill, and the rest of the team there have been able to juggle so many things at the same time, which quite frankly, there's very few companies who have in this sector that have actually been able to do that successfully. A lot of them stalling out, a lot of them not delivering on promises that they've made for years. Proud to say you guys are not one of them. How about current uranium market conditions here, Paul? Some of the events recently, maybe just speak to maybe over the last 30, maybe 60 days, some things actually predicted by you, at least partially predicted on a number of months ago, is potentially transpiring in Kazakhstan, a pretty sticky set of events that will impact certainly the question of certainty and diversity of supply, and will possibly leave even more impacts depending on how it goes. But comments on the Kazakhs and other sector events recently.
As everybody's been following, the news out of Kazakhstan has been that of a bit surprising with respect to the riots and the revolt, so to speak, depending on who's narrating the discourse at the time. But, we hear it's called, there was a coup, but also that we hear there's riots and the Russians and others had to be brought in to help stabilize the country. Kazatomprom, which is the government-owned entity that's been producing uranium there, has stated that they've had no interruptions in their production, but they may have further delays that could be coming out due to supply chain issues resulting from COVID. But also, one can't discount the fact that the transportation issues and everything else that have occurred can only impact their supply chain as well. And so I see that going forward. And you're right, we did discuss this in the past about the uncertainty around Kazakhstan and its business model, the way it's been running business. Based on all the messaging coming out of the Kazakh government, it does not seem to be that it's going to be business as usual. There will be some significant changes. There's discussions of increased taxing on mining companies, but also a restructure of the primary owner of Kazatomprom through the sovereign wealth fund there. I'm taking more of a wait and see attitude, but it's most interesting looking at it is the fact that the Russians have basically picked their winner over there, and that's the current government. And the former government, represented by former President Nazarbayev, it appears that there's quite a bit of house cleaning that's going on. And those are significant players in the buildup of Kazatomprom and the Kazakh industry. And so it's going to be interesting to see how things play out over the next few months. And other factors in the market that are going on, as you know, the big news last year was Sprott and the Sprott Physical Uranium Trust. I still think that's still got a role to play in the market going forward. Everything's kind of slowed down right now. The spot market's gotten relatively quiet, but and there seems to be a sentiment that that's, you know, it's somehow not a, you know, good sign where it's kind of leveled out. But I'll remind our listeners that where were we at a year ago? We were $10 a pound less a year ago. 3 years ago, we were probably even, you know, $20 less than where we are today. So we're at a good benchmark right now. And if we believe that this is the floor, I think we've got a lot of opportunity going forward as we expect demand to continue to increase as production, even with prices in the 40s, we haven't seen any increases in price and production around the world. Everything that's going to feed the current spot market is basically coming from either committed material or inventory material going forward. Lots of opportunities for improving market conditions. That also coupled with the fact that we know that putting all your eggs in one basket, that is delivering out of one particular country, that shows that you know, there are some risks there going forward. So lots of opportunities going forward in the market. And obviously, I think it's going to be a situation where we're going to have rising waters and all the boats are going to be floating.
Certainly agree. These boats, you know, not all of them are yachts. Some of them are dinghies. Some of them have holes. Some are leaking. Lots of different classes of vessels out there floating around, as you know, Paul. And yeah, with Spuddy, we'll see what happens with Spuddy and this New York listing and also some of these rebalancing that'll happen with some of the ETFs. And Kazakhstan, depending on what happens, which I think it's too early to fully figure this one out, but will the West be put on notice? And will some of the Western operators in that country be put on notice? And will some of the other arrangements also become all of a sudden not so safe as they were deemed? Let's put it that way. And then it puts pressure on other jurisdictions, right? Where you've got Australia and you've got places like Namibia and Niger to some extent, and Canada, North America becoming maybe the places that are maybe of more choice. And so it is interesting here. It's going to highlight a number of issues. And I think there's a lot of surprises yet to come out of this. So we'll see what happens. Talk about term contracting for a moment, Paul, and we'll get into the company specific stuff on this in a moment, but just broad term contracting activity. You know, there's a little bit of feelers out there as far as, you know, some RFPs and some things that happened, a little bit of activity, but still fairly quiet. What are you hearing and seeing out there?
I would characterize it like you did. It was the term market is still rather tentative at this moment. In other words, there's a few RFPs that come out from large utilities that have been coming out into the market. A few contracts have been taken up, but it's not the robust base escalated contracting that we've seen in past up markets, where pricing reflects the, you know, those base escalated pricing are reflecting operational costs plus, you know, additional revenues. So it's still got a ways to go. The one thing that a fuel buyer doesn't get rewarded for is to be upside down on pricing. So in other words, to go out and sign a contract with a premium pricing on it, and the underlying basis for that premium pricing doesn't deliver, and then it's a negative on that fuel buyer's budget, et cetera. So since most of the utilities have signaled that they have sufficient inventories and sufficient deliveries coming in to satisfy their needs to effectively through 2023, that there's not a sense of crisis yet to go out and do a whole bunch of flood the market with requests for proposals to start term contracting today. That's not to say they won't be doing it over the near term. I'm just saying that based on my conversations with the utilities, they're just not a crisis mode yet. In fact, the worst thing they want to do is make a commitment when there's uncertainties in the market. So the last uncertainty we had was the Sprott Physical Trust coming in and buying up uranium and increasing the price. There's a sense that if they start putting pressure on the market, particularly in the out years, that could create higher costs for the utilities. So they're going to wait. They're kind of wait and see what SPUT does over the next period of time, typically after they get their NYSE listing. Also, the uncertainty out of Kazakhstan. No one really knows what that means today. What's that going to mean in a year? Since there's not a crisis mode yet, they have time to evaluate those risks. And there'll be something else that comes up that pushes out a little bit, those decision-making factors going out a little further. So the utilities are actually putting on RFPs and accepting deals right now are the ones that are going to get the best deals, I think, going forward. I think it's as people wait out the market and wait for more, quote-unquote, certain conditions, that they're going to end up missing the better buying opportunities. I think the first movers are going to be rewarded over a period of time. And I would say that the feedback I've gotten from the utilities is that the one thing is where the spot price is now relative to the cost of production, it's becoming an easier conversation to have for base escalated pricing or, you know, higher ceilings on market-based contracts now than it would have been a year ago. But we're not at the point where they're willing to put a premium on that secure supply right at the moment, because obviously it appears there's an appearance that there's plenty of material out there based on the lack of movement in the spot market. So nobody wants to be second guessed on either side of the tables. You know, there's always a concern about leaving money on the table as well. So it's going to take a little bit more time, and there's going to be a whole lot more conversation with utility fuel buyers that we'll have, the rest of the industry will have as well.
Yeah, it seems like there certainly remains to be a perceived comfort level out there in the market with regards to term. And I suspect that it's going to be a situation where that comfort is there all the way to the last second before the rug gets pulled, you know. Yeah. So we'll see what happens. There's certainly some parties that are looking early to do things. And I think that's pretty evident. If you look at some certain utilities who have been a little more proactive about that, the better deals are to be had now rather than later. How about M&A stuff? Paul, you guys have been, perhaps some would argue about this, but really, in my view here, you guys have been the most active with respect to meaningful M&A work actually executed. Why is Encore, in your eyes, more successful on this front over others? And what can investors expect 2022 on this front?
I would call the completion of the Azarga transaction is huge. But it takes a little bit of boldness to get there, not a little bit, a lot. You know, that success is driven by experience. And with the team we have, particularly our executive chairman, Bill Sheriff, who's shown success in doing the M&A transactions in the past, a good model for that is what was done with Energy Metals. It requires quite a bit of bold leadership, and a good one. You know, we picked up the Westwater assets, which a lot of people in the past have basically discounted significantly due to their age and levels of depletion. But what he knew and what the company decided to do was that we need that the one that wins is the one that has the ability to leverage a market. In a uranium mining sector, having licensed and permitted facilities is the fastest way to get that leverage. And so we were able to build that, transform the company from being effectively a property or an exploration company to being an actual near-term producer. Now, I would say that we've had to do additional acquisitions to get there, both in properties as well as near-term production assets in Texas, to be able to build a portfolio to support that, those licensed facilities. It fundamentally transformed the company, and we can see from the equity side that the market rewarded us for that transaction. And we were able to leverage that success plus our other known resource, which is our experience of doing these, and actually leverage that to build out the acquisition of Azarga as a company. And so we, you know, it took a lot of work to get there, but it does show that we have the ability to demonstrate success and provide that performance there. I think that strengthens our hand going forward. We'll always be looking for opportunities, but I think what distinguishes Encore from others is that we're not picking up just small projects or acquiring properties that other people don't want or discarding and using that to build a portfolio built around effectively pounds in the ground. We're building our company around actually being a producing company supported by the pounds that are on ground, not looking to, you know, just basically build up a whole bunch of assets and look to sell to somebody else. we think we're going to be able to carry that strength going forward, and we'll continue to look for opportunities where they make sense and are creative to what we're doing right now.
Paul, I certainly agree with a lot of the things you said. I think one of the things that may have been overlooked here is I think the personalities that are involved in these M&A work is absolutely critical. And the Encore team has the proper set of personalities and people behind it that, in my view, and have proven into the market that this is a exceptional additional asset that you guys have as your intellectual know-how and the personalities that come with the team versus a number of other management teams that are stuck on themselves or can only see one way, tunnel vision, aren't creative enough and don't have the personality to be able to deal with the other personalities on the counterparty side. I think that's a huge component here. And I think a lot of folks are lacking in that category. And so far it's proven out to be true. Maybe money will change that, but still it's a value proposition. Performance-wise, I need to point this out. You know, so far in this cycle, the best equity performance has been Encore Energy by a notable margin, going back from the cycle lows around 2 pennies per share to a recent high of about 2.14 per share. And credit to the overall strategy and execution is a big part of this and the people. How do you keep this momentum going as the company grows, as the cycle matures, and as the market rewards those proper strategies needed to take advantage of the later stages?
That's always the rub, right? So as you get bigger, as you begin to basically increase the size and the strength of the company, the number of, I would say, M&A targets become much more selective at that point. So easy wins become more of a challenge. So you got to look for the wins that are going to be there, that are going to actually get you to the end result that makes sense. As you look forward, what's the next potential target? I see a lot of people in various messages, you know, Twitter and everything else, have lots of suggestions of where the next target is. Well, those are possibilities, but there may be other ones that we're not talking about that may be more creative and maybe bring us to a larger tier scale and change our whole peer profile. But it gets a lot more challenging at the moment because, you know, you look where our market cap is relative to our peers. We're starting to get into a much smaller peer size group based on our market cap. And so that creates, you have to look for what's going to be the best opportunity that's going to build your strength without diluting your strategy. So, you know, as I've said, our strategy is to become the newest ISR producer in the U.S., premier and an ISR dominant production scale company, which means that there's some areas we won't be competing in, which is like with conventional assets and other things, because that would dilute our strategy and dilute our focus. Again, we begin to narrow our potential M&A target group from a much broader group to something a little bit more narrow. You know, we focus in the U.S., which creates a narrower group, but also we're not ruling out, international opportunities as they present themselves. It's just that our expertise, our strengths have been focusing the domestic world rather than international basis. So even though our team has international experience, it's just that our operating experience is really strong in the U.S. and North America. Again, we're continuing to advance our strategy based on executing our plan, and we're doing it and doing carrying a lot of balls at once. Currently, so far, we haven't dropped any. I think that we'll be able to carry forward. But it does, as you meet these milestones and hit these achievements, you're always moving up. So as you know, the next bar becomes a little bit higher, and that's what we're focusing on.
The development, production, and also some exploration upside, I think, is also a key part here, which you guys have clearly included here, a production development side. That's critical. And a good guy for the job there, of course, to take care of that as well. So good on you for the efforts and managing the time, because I know it's pretty well pressed every day. On the general and administrative matters, Paul, I want to talk about a few things here for a moment. But can you update the listeners on where we are with the capital structure of the company post this Arzaga transaction, in terms of shares out, where you guys sit with cash on hand, and also if you can note some of them major shareholders post-transaction?
Okay. As far as cash on hand, we have approximately 15 million Canadian equivalent in cash and equivalents. So we count our 100,000 pounds of uranium as liquid. And for that cash and equivalent, you know, we had, obviously, when you do a transaction like we did, there's some cash flow that goes out as a process. So we've been talking about 20 million roughly, and we're down to about 15 million, which covers our, you know, basically our base plan going forward for 2022. It doesn't give us a lot of upside to do more than what we plan to do, but for the moment, we're in good shape. As far as our outstanding shares, I believe approximately just under 300 million shares outstanding and issued, about 330 million fully diluted. I haven't gone through to do a full census of our shareholders. We know that there's a few shareholders like L2 that was a big shareholder within Encore, as well as the Zarga that came along, and a few others that and some of the ETFs have combined their shareholdings in us. But I haven't got, I'll be honest with you, we need to go back and do another census on the institutional holders and large holders. Keep in mind, we're only 13 days post-transaction, so I should have a better answer to it next time we talk.
I appreciate the information on where we are, capital structure, and some updates that'll come out on that as we move forward here. And then also tied in with this, there'll be probably some cap structure changes with this NASDAQ listing. Talk about that for just a moment. How's it coming along? And do you have a rough expected completion for that?
So it's coming along well. We submitted the application late November. We're going through responding to that, the exchange's questions. They have several questions on the structure of the company, et cetera, both pre and post listing. We have not set any kind of ratio yet on, obviously we're going to have to meet the thresholds, which based on our current share price will require a consolidation. But the level of consolidation hasn't been settled yet. So we'll have to do a reverse split. But as to what that number is, what that ratio is, we haven't determined yet. Then I'll be determined close as we get closer and closer to getting that listing and getting a target. We're still shooting for, we'd love to have it done by the end of the month. But I think we've been guiding to Q1. I think that's the safe as the outside date is Q1. But we would really love to get it done as soon as we can this month. But we can only go as fast as the exchange goes.
Yeah, it sounds good, Paul. And appreciate your guys' efforts on that. I think as the cycle matures here, I think it's the right thing to do as the company grows. And to be honest with you, there's not a lot of companies that are looking at exchange uplists, and which I think you guys have followed a strategy here that makes a lot of sense based on your size, based on market conditions. And we'll see if some others wake up and follow suit on the coattails of the Encore strategy, if you will. How about term agreements that have been announced for the company? Most recently, there was a second one. All this coming out of the prospective production centers of the company. Last one that we saw was going to commence in 2024, if I recall, and I have a good idea who that buyer is. But talk about the terms where you can, of course, and give us a flavor for what you think for the company's production profile and the company's cost profile. What do you think is reasonable when you guys talk about prices?
First of all, we have the two agreements. We announced the UG agreement. That is a total of 2 million pounds cumulative over a period of 5 years. It's a very good contract. It's market-based solely. There's no floors, no ceilings. There's ability to deliver into from non-produced pounds. Obviously, we have to pay. We'll have to provide them a little bit more of a discount on that. But I can tell you that the terms are excellent and the flexibility it provides. Gave me the confidence to get the go-ahead to start building out the facilities to go to production. The second agreement, which we announced, was with a domestic utility, large utility, and that's also market-based. And as I mentioned to you earlier, we haven't been able to get a point to where we can establish base escalated pricing, which are within our where we see prices need to be to incentivize production. So we've been comfortable doing the market ones if the counterparty is, and we did establish this one in place. It is a market-based pricing, but there is a ceiling to it. But it's a decently high ceiling that gets us, particularly where we expect our production costs to be in the 30s, mid-30s right now. We'll see how things shake out with the current inflationary things we see on the horizon, but certainly will remain profitable even at that ceiling that's established. Currently, obviously, we've got a lot of room on the spot price right now to get to that ceiling. So I'm pretty comfortable where they're at. It provides another 1.3 million pounds of demand. the accomplishment of these two contracts do is at least they take care of our first, well, at least the first 3 years of production. Basically, they consume all of our demand needs. And so it gives us some tremendous flexibility for the next round of RFPs coming out. When the next one comes out, we could stand to wait for a little bit higher pricing, et cetera. And it really, we have a good strong book to get us kicked off. And it gives us the ability to establish what do we believe is conditions for future contracting with other utilities or even extending the ones we have now. I think we're good for that, and we'll be able to see good cash flow and profits once we start delivering into these.
I interpret these as basically the sustaining contracts that are needed to get comfortable. And then I suspect with a production profile and the anticipated future pipeline of the company, that a lot of leverage is going to carry in future contracts that you guys are going to get into. And then also it leaves you still uncovered for some of the pipeline as well. This establishes to get you guys comfortable. And then from here, things are going to get more sweet, if you will.
The other thing is that it does, you know, there are some companies out there that are 100% tied to contracts. I think Cameco, for all their 100% of the production, I think Cameco has been very clear that that's their strategy. And there's others that prefer to stay completely unhedged to the market. I think that's the proper term that's been used. And we kind of fall in the middle of that. Not that I'm looking for middle grounds, but I like to have, I've been doing this type of production profile before when I was with other companies. And establishing a good base source of demand gives you a lot of flexibility on the upside and doesn't preclude you from picking up the tops and the peaks and everything else, but allows you a good source of revenue. And when there are always times in the spot market when there's no demand, or the demand, you put material into the market, it's the wrong time of the month, so to speak, that this allows us the ability to deliver and be delivering, reflecting the market rather than basically chasing a spot price at the wrong time.
Yeah, I think this works really well. And again, there are some other components here that we haven't talked about as to why you would do these things. You know, to your comment about some of the folks who like to remain unhedged, while that is true with some that have a good strategy, that comment about remaining unhedged is also a cover for we can't get a contract, so we're just going to remain unhedged. you're no new party to this particular event in terms of how you go about structuring these things, and neither is Bill. On this topic, maybe just talk a little bit more about what you see going forward here in terms of the production profile at Oncor. Obviously, there's a growth pipeline here with some numbers yet to be determined, but, speak a little bit more to you, what your thoughts are on optimal mix of term contracts, what kind of uncovered exposure you would think works for a company like Oncor, and the growth pipeline that's to be included in this cycle, as compared to someone who maybe is a much larger producer, and the fact that smaller quantities can certainly be leaked into the spot market without much people really paying attention to that when volumes step up here, Paul. But talk about mix for Oncor and where you guys see where the leverage is really going to kick in.
We've been kind of messaging to the market that over the next 5 years, we want to be between, have a production capacity of between 3.5 to 5 million pounds per year. And that's from all sources. Obviously, that's I would call an aspirational range. So the reality is we want to be able to, and my preference would be to build our contract book to be able to sustain that type of production capacity to about, at least on a contracting basis, to about, assuming it's a mix of market-related and base escalated pricing, of about 60 to 70% of our production capacity. If it's strictly base escalated, it's going to be, or, fixed pricing or stuff like that, it would be something on the order of 50% where you have upside with the spot market. But I'm comfortable with market-related contracts to be able to expand that contract book out to 60 to 70% of our production capacity, giving us ability to deliver in the spot market if we exceed those numbers without impacting our sales on our contract. But that gives you the flexibility in the upside. So you have the one thing you want to have is the ability to not have to produce 100% of your capacity to meet your contracts. That's what this gives us flexibility to do. I look at it from a revenue basis. I want to be able to have enough revenue coming out on an annual basis, sustain operations and capital programs as we need to meet those production targets, but also be able to provide a return coming back in so that we have positive cash flow coming in. It gives us opportunities to grow and or provide returns back to, hopefully, back to our shareholders at that point. That's why I always like to have a little bit of open-ended on the top end of our production capacity over what we contract, because it gives you that flexibility to flex up and flex down as you need to without affecting your committed deliveries.
Assuming you guys execute on this, it also provides that type of platform provides the ability to survive, potentially also survive in a bear market, which, as you know, looking back at the last cycle, that survival rate was pretty poor, mostly because folks did not take that approach that you've outlined carefully here. And I think that's also a part is sustainability in the operations and actually having a view that this company is going to be an operating company and it's going to survive through, which I don't see that many folks figured that out during the last cycle. How about some of the project updates here, Paul, before we wrap up? Understand there's going to be some upgrades of historic resources to current 43-101 standards. What do you think will be some of the first updates that you guys will be working on this front? And what projects will be the first focus for these updates and also the timing? And then I want to come back to Rosita and Gas Hills for a moment.
Yeah, so we're focusing on some assets that we're not currently, well, we are currently advancing. So right now we're going to be updating expected to put out a 43-101 on our Butler Ranch properties. We were going to plan to do a drilling program there, but after we started going through the quality of data and the level of data we already have, it became very clear that with the drilling densities and everything that were carried forward by the prior owners, that we did not need to go out and do a whole bunch of drilling because we have core analysis. We actually have lab work and everything else on that data. It's the first time it's all been brought together because we had the database we acquired from Westwater, but also we had our own database we brought in. We're able to bring that in together and create the information necessary to be able to support a technical report for the Butler Ranch property. We're also looking at some assets that aren't located in Texas and upgrading those as well to 43-101 resources because we need to know what we have. Right now, with the historical resources, we haven't actually gone through and looked at what fits our business plan and what doesn't, but also what we should be looking at accelerating. So we don't have to do one for Dewey Burdock because that was recently done in 2020. We have Gas Hills, which was recently done in 2021. We did Wantafoya Marquez because that was one of those low-hanging fruit ones we could do relatively quickly. We're looking at a couple other properties we'll be bringing in. And also, the properties we're developing in Texas, we'll probably be doing 43-101s on those later this year. We're looking at doing one or two a year. We may do a few more this year because we have the data. And when you have the data in place, it's relatively inexpensive to get a independent 43-101 report done on those. But it allows you to establish your basis for your development, correct? And so by having that information and knowing what you have, it gives us the ability to plan and execute. So we're doing that right now. That's the paperwork exercise we're doing. In addition, we're doing field work to confirm some of our historical resources, particularly at the Rosita project. Rosita has not had a lot of recent development. It's been well over, probably 10 years since it's really been looked at hard. We started putting together the information, bringing in not only the database we acquired from Westwater, but also the database we've brought in from acquisitions we've done, and basically built a much bigger picture about what Rosita is, and also what we call our Upper Spring Creek project. And so that's where we're focusing our efforts. So kind of switch gears. You mentioned about getting into Rosita, et cetera. We started a drilling program. So we have already established where the well field's going. It's already an exempted aquifer, so we got the federal process already behind us. But as we began going through this data, we identified additional roll fronts and additional ore bodies that were never really characterized as quote unquote part of Rosita. And we've acquired the properties through leasing and everything to go after them. And we've started drilling on those right now to build out additional resources to effectively expand the resource base at Rosita. And we'll be putting a more formal report on that later this year as well. And we have the Upper Spring Creek project, which we acquired. We're acquiring in fee and in leasing that we identified through an acquisition of a database from a former operator called Signal Equities, a private company. And we're advancing that as well. We've already started the permitting and licensing work on that, as well as the expansion at Rosita. So we've just got a lot going on that's going to be expanding our resource, but also allowing us to increase the robustness of our known resource for the company as a whole to help support our production plan.
And Paul, just remind the audience here on Rosita, obviously some of this work you just mentioned, drilling and some of the updated on the resources, all of this is coming into Rosita Restart and gathering up feed for Rosita. But just talk about when you expect to have Rosita at the state where you guys are going to start canning cake.
We're looking at 2023. You know, we still have some work to do on putting in the well field. And I think that's going to consume, we'll have the plant ready to go by the end of this quarter. But the well field's going to take a little bit more time because you have to have drill rigs, get all that put in place. And that's going to take about 12 months. So we're looking at early 2023 on the inside as being our production start at Rosita. And I expect that Upper Spring Creek will be right on the heels of that in a 2023 production timeline. The main thing we want to do is be able to meet our production obligations with what we have with UG, and then be able to expand that to meet our utility contract as well, in addition to UG in 2024. So everything's built around those targets. So obviously the biggest challenge you have is getting drill rigs, and we've got our second one showing up this month, and we'll be hopefully having additional ones coming up, coming in quickly behind that, so we can begin executing that. Putting in the wells that we need to put in and establishing all those, the preliminary work we have to get set up to go into production.
Yeah, that's good to hear. And looking at some of the peers, there's not many people doing this, first of all, and I think there might be one or maybe two peers that may be able to do something maybe a little bit quicker here. But as far as I know, you guys are the only ones that are actually being serious here from what I've seen recently. Gas Hills for a moment, we'll leave Dewey Burdock. I think that's pretty clear for now. But Gas Hills, what do you think is going to be the accelerated focus on Gas Hills?
Well, the first thing we'll be doing is we're looking to do a limited drilling program out there. So we built into our plans for 2022 is to get a drilling permit, to go out there and do some drilling to confirm the data we have, but also we want to do some coring on getting some core done to evaluate the leaching characteristics a little bit better, but also to establish what we need for starting. We have to do a state permit to mine and start the licensing work. So this will get us the groundwork to get started there. It's going to be a good lift to get the Gas Hills to production. In other words, it's not my first rodeo on that part. I know what has to be done. I know the people we have to put in place and the key elements of that. It's just a matter of executing, getting it started. That'll all be commenced us starting in first quarter 2022. Once we get that going, it'll be a pretty straightforward path to production. And, we're kind of looking at getting Dewey Burdock up and running first before we go to Gas Hills. But who knows, it could be coming on simultaneously or however that works out, depending on the timing of the permitting process. So I got a good feeling about Gas Hills, but before I go put that on paper, I'd like to get a little bit more information.
Yeah, absolutely. Knowing the market conditions as well here. Before we go, how about non-core assets and potential divestment of those assets? Anything on this front of note that you want to mention?
Well, we have been looking at divesting some of our non-core assets. As I mentioned, we're looking to become principally an ISR producer, and we don't look to compete in the conventional spaces. I'm not going to say we won't, but right now that's not part of our strategy. So we've been looking at opportunities with some of our conventional properties. I believe it was announced a couple of months ago through another entity, I think it's called Evolving Gold, that we are selling our Sotayata project in Cibola County, New Mexico. That's a former Neutron Energy asset that came on board. Conventional play, good resources, but we're looking to do typical types of things like that to divest. There may be other opportunities that are coming up. We're always looking at, always evaluating strategies to improve the balance, the cash balance of the company, but also reduce holding costs, but also getting value for these assets, not just doing them, not doing divestments just for the sake of doing divestments, but where it makes sense. Obviously, we want to make sure that if we do divest to to somebody else if there's a reasonable financial opportunity for the company there when we do that.
Looking forward to seeing what happens there. And I know there's going to be some hungry juniors continuing to knock on the door, looking to do maybe some good deals there that predominantly be in Encore's favor. Well, to wrap up, for potential investors who are on the sidelines listening in here, market cap of the company stands at about 482 million Canadian. Why should they consider Encore Energy now at current levels?
And this is just strictly my opinion, is that I think we've still got a lot of room to grow. I think that our shareholders will see a lot of benefits once we get the NASDAQ listing, that we'll see more liquidity, which will improve the opportunity for improved market valuation. We've got a good solid growth plan going forward. You don't need to wait to get in. You can take part in it now. If you look at our track record in the past, we've actually shown tremendous growth, not only from a market share basis, but also just in what we're actually accomplishing. And we're doing it on a good cash constrained basis, to where we're not going out into spending money, our shareholders' money, without some thought and due diligence. And so I think it's a good value right now. I think it's an excellent value right now. I think in the future, we're going to be a much stronger value to our shareholders that we have today. And I think now is the time to look at us very hard as an opportunity going forward.
Looking forward to seeing more there on that. And certainly you guys, again, remain to be one of the most ambitious and most successful companies in the sector. And I think that'll continue. Best way for investors and the audience to reach out to the company with questions?
You can go to our website. That's www.encoreuranium.com. We have changed our domain name to make it easier for people to type it in and find us. Or you can send an email to info@encoreuranium.com, or you can call us at our head office at 361-239-5449.
Paul, always good to catch up and chat with you. Looking forward to it again. And in the meantime, keep up the good work.
Thanks a lot. Thanks for everything, Andrew, and best of luck. And again, Happy New Year.